ఇంకా 2 మినిట్స్ 1 మినిట్ జస్ట్ స్టార్ట్ అయినాక వెళ్ళు నువ్వు ఒక్క నిమిషం ఈ డోర్ క్లోజ్ చేయాలి ఇక్కడే ఉంటాం వెయిట్ చేస్తారు ఆ పేషెంట్ ఏం చేస్తారు
క్లాస్
We are live on YouTube, ma'am. We will start in 1 minute, okay?
Yes, sir.
Once, no problem. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 3F, which is soft tissue and bone tumors. We have a very, very interesting topic, the topic of much demand, diagnostic approach to bone tumors. And to talk on that, we have somebody who's a national and an international expert in bone tumors, Dr. Susila Kudandapani. She is an MD, PDCR. A fellowship in cytopathology. She's a senior consultant pathologist and head of the Department of Pathology and Clinical Trials at the very famous Basavatarakam Indo-American Cancer Hospital and Research Center, Hyderabad. She has done her postgraduate diploma in clinical research, fellowship in cytopathology from IAC. She has a teaching, faculty and the thesis guide for DNB pathology. She's an NABH certified assessor of ethics committee in accreditation, ICH CG GCP guideline trainer for NABH. She's a member secretary of Institute of Ethics Committee, Hyderabad. Guest speaker in the national and international pathology conferences with multiple national and international publications and peer-reviewed journals. A very famous person, a very efficient pathologist, and an expert in bone pathology. Before I ask her to start, let me request you to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please do not share your screen. With this, let me welcome Dr. Susila, ma'am. Please share your screen and let us start. Just press present now, your entire screen, and press in the center and right. We can see your screen. Just, yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Thanks for the very nice introduction. I think you are very partial towards me. You told very extra things.
No, ma'am. You are an expert. Just make the full
thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And I thank Percy also for giving me an opportunity to present on this platform. And my topic is diagnostic approach to bone tumors. Here I am going to share my personal experience, how I am approaching the bone tumors, and let us see how I am going to deal with the topic. So I'll be talking about the topic under the following headings, like clinical presentation, clues from radiology, updates in WHO classification 2020, and grossing according to CAP protocol, and the synaptic reporting of microscopic features and morphology of the common lesions which we come across in day-to-day practice, and the therapy-related changes in the bone tumors, and of course summarization. So reporting bone tumors is a multidisciplinary approach. We pathologists can't report alone, so we need the help of orthopedic surgeon, oncologist and radiologist before committing any impression So we need to know radiology first, at least basic radiology. So the clinical findings of bone cancer, they have unique features. They have particular site predilection. That is, certain tumors preferentially affect certain areas of skeleton. For example, skull will be affected by metastasis and myeloma, and adamantinoma will be seen in mandible and tibia. So like this, we have to be aware of the site predilection of each and every tumor. And coming to the age predilection, the tumors which happen in the childhood, like less than 10 years, will not happen in the more than 60 years. So these things also we should be aware before reporting bone tumors. Coming to the next location prediction, here also the tumors, they have the they choose their own location also, either diaphysis or metaphysis or epiphysis. So the round cell tumors usually affects the diaphysis, and the osteosarcoma affects the metaphysis, and GCT and ABC and osteochondroma, they occur in the epiphysis. So we should be very friendly with the radiologist, and the familiarity with the radiology is of utmost importance before reporting the bone tumors. And reliable diagnosis cannot be made without adequate radiographic information and correlation. So we should not forget the basics, that is at least X-ray, plain X-ray, we should be aware of all the lesions. And we should never hesitate to discuss with the radiologist, because they help us whenever we have any discordance in the report and all that. We have to discuss with the radiologist and come to the final conclusion. So coming to the radiological clues, so what are all the clues we get from the X-ray and CT scan? I am going to discuss only about the X-ray, because I am not an expert in CT scan and MRI. So I will be sharing all the knowledge what I have in X-ray. Okay, so the site, which part of the skeleton is involved, and the location, which part of the bone is involved, and the margin of the lesion, whether it is a narrow lesion with well-defined margins or it is a broader lesion with an ill-defined margin, the zone of transition is very important, and the nature of the lesion also, whether it is a lytic lesion or a sclerotic lesion. Coming to the damage of the bone, whether the cortical destruction with or without the soft tissue invasion, and is there any ballooning type of destruction. So the ballooning type of destruction will be seen in GCT and chondromyxoid fibroma, and the cortical destruction, complete destruction, will be seen in high grade malignancy and also in locally aggressive benign tumors. The soft tissue involvement without destruction will be seen in most of the round cell tumors and hematolymphoid malignancies. Coming to the site of bone involved, the epiphyseal lesions and diaphyseal lesions. So each tumor has their own specific location also. So we should be aware of it. So whenever we see the radiology, we should know where the lytic lesion is there and where the sclerotic lesion is there. So accordingly, we have to go and see under the microscope. So coming to the metaphyseal lesion, there is a big list. But one thing we have to remember, no tumor listens to our words. So overlapping occurs very often. So diametaphyseal and epidiaphyseal, all these things will happen. So, and central and eccentric lesions are also very important, because enchondroma and all that will occur eccentrically, and osteochondroma has a projection in the from the cortex. So all these things we should keep it in mind, and after seeing the X-ray only we should see under microscope. Coming to the number of the lesion, most of the primary bone tumors are solitary lesions, and if there are multiple bone lesions, first and foremost we have to rule out metastasis if the patient is an old male or old female, and myeloma. And if the person is a young person, it could be enchondromas and vascular lesions also. Coming to the growth pattern, if it is having a geographic pattern, that is a well-defined lesion, means it could be a unicameral bone cyst or chondromyxoid fibroma or non-ossifying fibroma. So if it is having a permeative pattern, it involves medullary as well as cortical bone, it must be a high-grade malignant neoplasms. But one thing we have to remember is, even chronic osteomyelitis will also have a permeative pattern. So we have to rule out osteomyelitis before committing into malignancy. And another thing is moth-eaten pattern. So from the X-ray itself, we know it is an aggressive tumor having infiltrative borders. So it will be seen in osteosarcoma as well as in Ewing sarcoma. So coming to the periosteal reaction, it may be benign or aggressive. So whenever we see a cortical thickening, so we should think of the reactive changes, that is healed trauma or chronic osteomyelitis first before committing into a tumor. And endosteal expansion is most commonly seen in a low-grade chondrosarcoma. Coming to the type of matrix produced by the tumor, so osteoid, malignant osteoid shows ill-defined amorphous deposits and densities, which is showing the Hoffsard mineralization. So when we see something like this in an X-ray, we should think of a malignant lesion, that to osteoid producing lesion. And if it is a chondrite, we see tiny calcification, which are arc-like or ring-like calcification will be there, and it will be stippled character. And in fibrous matrix, it will be having a ground glass appearance. And epiphyseal lesion, we should always remember before the fusion of growth plate as well as after the fusion of growth plate, because the lesion will be looking same morphology, same site and all that, only the age will be different in the patient. So if it is before the fusion of growth plate, it is chondroblastoma. If it is after the fusion of growth plate, it may be GCT or ABC. If it is epi metaphyseal lesion, it may be GCT, ABC or giant cell rich osteosarcoma. Giant cell rich osteosarcoma, again we should see the other features in the X-ray. So I think we had enough of radiology. Let us go into pathology. Any doubts? So this is our hospital. So coming to the recent updates in the WHO classification 2020, fifth edition. There are many modifications compared to the fourth edition of WHO. And let us see one by one. So the updates in the classification, mainly the molecular testing plays an important role. The Ewing sarcoma, which has been classified so far in the bone tumors, has been classified separately as undifferentiated small round cell sarcomas of bone and soft tissue. So under this, first is Ewing sarcoma, second one is round cell sarcoma with, that is EWSR1 non-ETS fusions or CIC rearranged sarcoma. The fourth one is sarcoma with BICA genetic alterations. Each and every tumor has their own molecular pattern and ILC. I will come to it later. So the other modification in the classification is atypical cartilaginous tumor versus chondrosarcoma 1. It is similar to the atypical lipomatous tumor and liposarcoma. Previously, atypical cartilaginous tumor was classified under benign. Now it has become an intermediate category, and chondrosarcoma, obviously it is a malignant category. So it depends, the morphology wise both look the same. Only thing is the involvement of bone. If it involves the appendicular skeleton, it is called atypical cartilaginous tumor. If it involves the axial skeleton, it is called chondrosarcoma grade 1. So according to the bone involved, the diagnosis varies. And next is the changes in the osteosarcoma. The conventional osteosarcoma, now it has been named as osteosarcoma NOS. So under osteosarcoma NOS, the conventional sarcoma, it includes osteoblastic variant, chondroblastic variant, sclerosing variant, giant cell variant, as well as the other things. And telangiectatic osteosarcoma as well as the small cell osteosarcoma also come under the osteosarcoma types. The periosteal, paraosteal, they are all separate types. And next is osteoclastic giant cell rich tumors. Previously, giant cell lesions, ABC, are all differently classified as an unknown origin. Now they are all put together as osteoclastic giant cell rich tumors. And the fibrohistic ascitic tumor, which is a non-ossifying fibroma, also comes under the giant cell rich tumor category. And in giant cell rich category also, there are benign cases as well as malignant cases. Malignant GCT also included in this. And chordoma, which is the tumor of notochordal origin, previously it was classified as conventional chordoma. Now it has been further classified as poorly differentiated, de-differentiated chordoma. Then fibrohistiocytic tumors are removed from the classification. Hope I am clear. Am I audible, sir? Hello?
So, absolutely clear, just go ahead.
Okay, absolutely. Sir. So these are the different bone specimens which we receive in our lab. So either it is percutaneous needle biopsy, that is a true cut needle biopsy, which we obtain from the radiology department under CT guidance or ultrasound guidance, and we get 2 to 3 centimeter lengthy biopsy, or 2 or 3 cores we used to get. And what we do, we embed the cores in a different cassette, so that if one core gets spoiled in one cassette, the other core will be preserved. It's always ideal, whenever we get small biopsies, we have to divide into two cassettes and process as a two blocks. And open biopsy or punch biopsy and excision biopsy, which excises the tumor in toto, and transiliac bone marrow biopsy, it is a driven biopsy. So it is done for metabolic disorders as well as in hematological disorders for staging also. And limb salvage procedure, it is the new entry in the department of orthopedics, that is post chemo. All the malignant tumors, when we were all MBBS students, once bone cancer means amputation was the treatment of choice. Now, after the advent of chemotherapy and all that, now the patients are given chemotherapy 3 cycles, 4 cycles, the tumor burden is reduced and limb salvage procedure is done, which saves the limb of the patient so that the patient can walk about after the surgery also. And last is amputation. It is done in the recurrent cases or very late stage cases. And this is the bone cutting machine which we have in our department. And here, this is the process by which the bone is cut. It is like a wood is cut in the sawmill. It is like that. And two sections. We can make thin sections. So coming to the gross format, it is according to the CAP protocol. So this is the format which we use in our lab. So what is the procedure, whether it is a core needle biopsy or curettage, which is done for a GCT or aneurysmal bone cyst or in hemangioma, or excisional biopsy, amputation. So that site of tumor site, appendicular skeleton, it has to be mentioned clearly referring to the radiological picture. And spine or pelvis, whatever in pelvis, we have to specify which bone, whether it is ischium or ilium, we have to mention that. And tumor location and extent, whether it is involving epiphysis, metaphysis or diaphysis, or epimeta or metadiaphysis, all the things we have to mention. And whether the cortex is involved and medullary cavity, only the medullary cavity is involved, or any surface involvement is there, or any soft tissue extension is there, whether it is involving the nearby joint, all the things we have to mention in the gross at the time of grossing itself. And the tumor size and appearance of the tumor is very important. For example, in this, there are gray white and fleshy areas as well as hemorrhagic and necrotic areas, and there are some areas of normal bone marrow also. Such things we have to mention. And regarding the resected margin also, we have to comment. If the margin is here, we can make out the tumor is well away from the margin, so we have to give the resected margin also. So any nodes, any satellite nodules are seen, that also should be sampled. Coming to the post-chemotherapy cases, the grossing in post-chemotherapy cases are little different, because in post-chemotherapy cases, we have to submit the bone in toto, because we don't know how much extent the bone has extended, and we have to assess the grade of the tumor and the grade of the response also. Here we have to do the, this is called the gridding. So you have to make it, and 1, 2, 3 like that, we have to give number, and you have to draw the same picture in our gross form also, and mention which block is from which area. And we have to note down any pre-resection treatment is given, what is the chemotherapy given, whether radiation therapy is given, that has to be mentioned, because the changes will be different for chemo and radio. And what is the treatment effect, whether any treatment effect is seen grossly, or if it is present, whether it is the necrosis or hemorrhage, something we have to mention. And if percentage we could make out, we have to mention the percentage also. So briefly about the decalcification, because without decalcification we can't see the section and the microscope. So I think many people can understand what is CITES, ALTES, FORTES. So it is the Olympic this thing. So in Latin it means faster, higher and stronger. So the decalcifying agent should be faster, higher. Higher means it should be good and it should be strong also, because the sections should be properly cut. So the good decalcifying agent should remove the calcium completely, and it should cause less damage to the tissues, and the staining, that is further staining, should not be affected by the decalcification, either immunohistochemistry or the routine H&D staining, and the decalcifying process should be fast. So for us in our department, we are using nitric acid, which is 10% nitric acid we use for the big bones, and for bone marrow biopsy and all that, we are using ion exchange resin. Here they exchange areas of the calcification. And the microscopy wise, it is hypocellular with abundant matrix, that is hyaline cartilaginous matrix is is seen, and the chondrocytes are showing no ATPR. So it is a case of chondroma. Coming to the next case, chondroblastoma. Here the X-ray shows well circumscribed lytic expansive lesion with sclerosis of the border. And grossly it is white, firm, and rarely it may be cystic. Small cysts are seen. And microscopy wise, there is mixture of mononuclear cells as well as osteoclast giant cells. We can make out osteoclast giant cells here. And distinct borders are seen for the cells. And pink cytoplasm will be there, and there is longitudinal groove. Sorry, I didn't put the higher magnification. Longitudinal groove will be seen in that, and chondrite matrix with calcification. It is called chicken wire calcification. So IHC wise, it's staying the all the neoplastic cells cross. Under microscope, there will be thick and hyaline cartilaginous cap, which is containing cells in the lacuna, and it matures the via the endochondral calcification, and the bony trabeculae surrounded by fat and bone marrow elements are seen. Coming to the next entity, chondrosarcoma. Here the cortical thickening will be there and cortical destruction is there, and the periosteal reaction will be there in the X-ray, which forms the arcs and rings. Grossly, it will be bluish gray with foci of calcification. This is the specimen in the postoperative. Grossly bluish gray with foci of calcification we can make out, and erosion and destruction of cortex may be seen with soft tissue extraction. Chondrosarcoma, they are divided into three grades, that is grade 1, 2, 3. So sarcoma grade 1, both have the similar morphology. I have already told, according to the bone involved, it is labeled as appendicular. If it is involving appendicular, it is called ACT. If it involves the axial skeleton, it is called as chondrosarcoma grade 1. So here the cellularity is little increased and the hyperchromatic and grade 2, it is between the 1 and 3. Here the cellularity will be more and nuclear changes will be hyperchromatic, and marker cellularity will be seen in the grade 3, and nuclear pleomorphism is marked with frequent mitosis. Here the IHC S100 helps, and there are some abnormal figures also, and we can make out mitotic figure. And IDH1 and 2 mutation will be seen in these cases, except in secondary peripheral type chondrosarcoma grade 2 and 3. Coming to the dedifferentiated chondrosarcoma, here chondrosarcoma with abrupt transition to high grade sarcoma. Sorry for the poor staining. This is the cartilage. This happens because of improper decalcification. If the decalcification is not properly, then the understaining of the tissue will happen. So here the eosinophilic thing is looking little prominent, but the hematoxylin is dull. And here the cartilage part is there, chondrosarcoma. So this is called a dedifferentiated chondrosarcoma. And IHC wise, INH 1 and 2 variably present in both the areas, admixed with cartilaginous areas. The main important thing we should remember is many a times we get true cut biopsy. The true cut biopsy, CT guided true cut biopsy, if the true cut biopsy is taken from this area, we will be getting small round cell population with admixed vessels. So we might commit mistakes of calling it a small round cell favoring, because mesenchymal chondrosarcoma also occurs in young children, so we might commit as Ewing sarcoma. In such cases, we have to see the X-ray, and then we should think which part of the bone is involved and what is the site and what is the nature of the lesion we have to see, because the chondrosarcoma will have calcifications which will not be seen in the Ewing sarcoma, and Ewing sarcoma involves the diaphysis. And ISC-wise, CD99 and SOX9 will be seen in the round cells. This is another complication, because CD99 will be positive in Ewing's also. So only by doing one ISC, we should not decide about the diagnosis. If CD99 comes positive, then we have to do FLY1 and NKX2.2, which will be negative in mesenchymal chondrosarcoma, which will be positive in Ewing sarcoma. And S100 stains only the cartilage part. So coming to the next, these are other focus of mesenchymal chondrosarcoma. We can make nice, because the same patient, when we got the true cut biopsy, we had difficulty because we thought it is Ewing's, and after seeing the X-ray, we got confused, and NKX 2.2 has come negative. So we, in view of NKX 2.2 negativity, the possibility of Ewing sarcoma ruled out. So the possibility any other round cell tumor list we have given. Then the excision specimen came and it showed the cartilaginous areas and nice hemangiopericytoma appearance. This is a higher magnification showing the round cells as well as the cartilage. Hope there are no questions. So coming to osteoid forming lesions. So osteoid osteoma, it is an X-ray diagnosis which shows the nidus of the nidus in the bone. So it is a typical radiolucent nidus. So which is having a sclerotic rim. The same thing will be reflected in the gross specimen also. There will be a sclerotic rim with central granular appearance, which is reddish, and the microscopy wise the same thing will be composed of thin interconnected spicules of osteoid and woven bone rimmed by osteoblasts. So sometimes we might commit mistakes of calling it as osteosarcoma. So in such cases we have to see the pleomorphism and mitosis, because there also we will be seeing, but the texture of bone will be mature in this case of osteosarcoma, but in osteosarcoma it will be immature. And osteoclast giant cells will be seen here and there. Coming to the osteosarcoma, conventional osteosarcoma, the X-ray is a spotter for all of us in MBBS also. It will be having the sunburst appearance and periosteal elevation and Codman triangle will be there. And grossly, we can see gray-white gritty mass encasing the bone end, and it is heavily mineralized and areas of hemorrhage and cystic change is seen. And coming to the microscopy, it can be osteoblastic, showing the osteoblastic cells lining the newly formed osteoid. Lace-like pattern, the osteoid is seen in lace-like pattern, and it is unmineralized as well as mineralized trabeculae are seen, and it could be chondroblastic where the islands of or lobules of cartilage are seen, and here the cartilage chondrocytes are seen in the lacunae. They show marked anaplasia. So here the we should not commit the mistake of chondrosarcoma. And chondroblastic variant of osteosarcoma occurs in young children and are less than 15 years, and chondrosarcoma comes in the later age group. So that is also a clue from the age predilection as well as from the X-ray. And molecular wise, periosteal and low grade central osteosarcoma, they are MDM2, they show MDM2 mutation. This is a fibroblastic variant of osteosarcoma showing plump spindly cells and scanty osteoid. So when we get a true cut biopsy containing only spindle cell population like this, we will call it as malignant spindle cell neoplasm involving the bone. It could be fibrosarcoma or it could be fibroblastic osteosarcoma. We can't commit osteosarcoma till we see the osteoid. Coming to the next lesion, recently we got this lesion. It is a giant cell rich osteosarcoma. Numerous giant cells are seen. Here also, when the true cut biopsy came, we thought it is a GCT, but the radiology is not fitting it because it is looking like an aggressive tumor in radiology. So we asked the surgeon to repeat the biopsy and it showed the osteoid areas. We can see the lace-like osteoid amidst the giant cells. Coming to the small cell osteosarcoma, this is another DD for Ewing sarcoma. So here also NKX 2.2 and SADB2 we have to do to differentiate between these two tumors. And we have to look for the thin osteoid. In small cell osteosarcoma, we have to really search for osteoid. It will not be seen very obviously. And coming to the next category, it is telangiectatic osteosarcoma. Here the vascular channels will be there and highly anaplastic cells will be surrounding the areas of hemorrhage. So this is the point. The anaplastic cells are the clue for the diagnosis. Otherwise, we commit a mistake of ABC by seeing the vascular channels without endothelial lining. So coming to the ISC SADB2 nuclear stain is nuclear stain, and it stains the nuclei of the osteoblast. So it is a case of osteoblastic osteosarcoma, the same case where we saw lace like it. The osteoid is not getting stained, only the tumor cells are getting stained. So this is a view of our hospital. Any doubts, anything means you can put it in the chat box. Coming to the next entity, it is undifferentiated small round cell sarcoma. The first one is Ewing sarcoma. X-ray wise, we see the onion peel appearance of this thing. It involves the diaphyseal region and this multi-layering in the periosteum is very important in cases of Ewing sarcoma. And grossly, it has gray white tumor extending into soft tissue also, and necrotic and hemorrhagic areas will be seen. And microscopically, uniform population of cells will be there, and with the finely granular chromatin. And the indications for poor prognosis is whenever there is recurrence and whenever it involves the axial skeleton, we called it as poor prognosis. And here the monotonous population of cells with the eosinophilic cytoplasm, and they show CD99 membranous positivity and Fly1-NKX2. This is NKX2.2 stain, which is a nuclear stain. It shows the positivity in Ewing sarcoma. And FISH-wise, molecular FISH analysis showing the breakabout signal representing EWSF gene rearrangement. So coming to the undifferentiated small round cell sarcoma, EWSR1 non-ETS fusions have different partners. One is FUS, NFAT-C2, which is CD99 and NKX2.2 showing variable positivity, but CD138 comes positive in this tumor. Morphology wise, they all look like Ewings. So if CD138 comes positive, we will think that it could be plasmacytoma or plasmablastic lymphoma. So in such cases, we have to be very careful and do other stains to rule out plasmacytoma. And PATZ PATS 1 shows CD99 negative. Though the morphology wise it resembles Ewing's, it is CD99 negative, but it is positive for all this CD34, S100, SOX10, Desmin and Myo-D1. So we should be very careful when we choose our antibodies also. And next thing is CIC, rearranged sarcoma. Here there is fusion of CIC and DUX4 gene. So this can be identified by FISH analysis. And the peculiarity of this tumor is it doesn't involve bone often. It involves the deep soft tissues and it is a highly aggressive tumor. And ISC wise, it shows the patchy CD99 positive. Usually in Ewing sarcoma, then CD99 positivity will be diffuse and diffuse membranous. But here it will be patchy and NKX2.2 is negative, but WT1 will be positive. So if it occurs in the abdomen, deep abdomen, near kidney and all that, and it occurs again in children, so the other possibility of Wilms tumor to be ruled out because WT1 comes positive. So we should be very careful in labeling the lesion. Sarcoma with Bicar genetic alterations. It is also a new entity. It is otherwise called as primitive myxoid mesenchymal tumor of infancy. Here the tumor cells are very primitive and it will be having a myxoid. Sorry, I don't have photograph for this. So the tumor cells are very primitive and myxoid background will be there. These cells very peculiarly positive for SADB2 and cyclin D1. So whenever cyclin D1 comes positive, we should not think of hematopoietic neoplasms. And since SADB2 comes positive, we should not think of small cell osteosarcoma. So in case if we have BCAR mutation, it will be well and good. Otherwise, we have to give the possibility of Bicar genetic alterations to be ruled out. So whenever we get bone round cell sarcoma, the IHC panel should include CD99, NKX2.2, Fly1, LCA. LCA also we have to do it to rule out any lymphoma, and WT1, SADB2, cyclin D, as well as Bicar. And FISH, if it is available, we should do. In case if you are thinking it is Ewing's, EWSR, Fly1, we have to do. Otherwise, CIC, DUX4, if available, we have to get it done in case the cells are positive for WT1. So next lesion is a vascular lesion, that is hemangioma. This is a case which we got it last year. Radiology wise, they all called it as ABC. So the curating is done for the lesion, and the curating and cementing was done, and it was involving vertebral body. And honeycomb appearance we could not make out because it was a curating. And we can see the sclerotic blood filled cavities and cavernous and capillary type of hemangioma is seen. Here the thin walled blood vessels are seen. One thing we have to remember is they all have endothelial lining, which is the differential point with the ABC. So it is not a case of ABC, it is a case of hemangioma occurring in the vertebral body. Here the radiology misguided us. So other lesion is hematopoietic neoplasms. So the two neoplasms which we come across very often is plasmacytoma and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma very rarely. So this is a case which we got it recently. It is a small baby came with the sclerotic lesion in the humerus, and they all thought it is Ewing sarcoma only. But when we did CD99, it has come negative, and then we did Fly1, NKX2, all came negative. Then we did WT1, that was also negative. Simply we did LCA, it has come grossly positive. So with this we came to the diagnosis of hematopoietic neoplasms, probably lymphoma. Then we did the IHC panel and all have come positive, and it is a case of DLBCL. That is why I told we should not leave LCA whenever we see a round cell tumor. If it is a plasmacytoma, it may be solitary or multiple, and IHC panel we all know, so we should do at least one or two first. If they come positive, then we should go ahead with kappa and lambda. We should use the IHC panel judiciously also, and as well as wherever it is necessary, we should not hesitate to do more markers. Coming to the next entity, that is tumors of mesenchymal origin. In this, fibrous dysplasia, this also we very frequently come across. It is a well-described, well-circumscribed lesion with sclerotic rim and ground glass appearance will be there in the X-ray. So that indicates there is no calcification, nothing is there, but the border, it is otherwise called as shepherd hook appearance in the thing. That is our MCET, I mean, entrance exam question also. In long bones, they are centered in the medulla and involve the metadiaphysis region, and grossly firm and fibrous gritty areas will be there, and irregular trabeculae of woven bone within the fibrous tissue will be there. It is called as Chinese letter pattern, and there will be no ATPA, and mitosis is very occasional. Coming to the next lesion, that is adamantinoma. It occurs very peculiarly in mandible and tibia only. It doesn't occur in any other bones. So here they have osteolytic and expansile lobulated lesion with moth-eaten appearance. And grossly, it involves the medullary cavity as well as the cortical bone, and it is firm to bony consistency with peripheral sclerosis. So the peripheral sclerosis is an indication it may be adamantinoma. So microscopically, irregular nest of epithelial tumor cells which are having a basaloid appearance, sometimes squamoid appearance, surrounded by fibrous stroma, but the mitotic activity is very low. Now coming to the tumor with notochordal differentiation. Benign notochordal tumor is one entity. Now coming to the chordoma. Chordoma is further classified into conventional chordoma, dedifferentiated chordoma, and poorly differentiated chordoma. Under the conventional chordoma, not otherwise specified, that is 95% percentage of occurrence, and the chondroid chordoma, which includes only 4 to 5%, where the chondroid matrix is more compared to the chordoma cells. This occurs in children and young adults. Usually cranial chordoma is a chondroid chordoma, or it may be conventional chordoma if it occurs in children and young adults. Typically in adults, it typically involves the clivus and sacrococcygeal bones, sometimes vertebra, and intraosseous is more than 95% of cases. Extra-axial skeleton is very rare, and soft tissue, if it occurs, it is called as chordoma perifericum, which is very rare in occurrence. Next, coming to dedifferentiated chordoma, less than 1% of chordomas are dedifferentiated. It is a biphasic tumor composed of a chordoma, NOS, plus high-grade sarcomatous transformation, having a very poor prognosis, and the poorly differentiated chordoma, which rarely occurs in the sacrum. So if it occurs in the sacrum, it can't be poorly differentiated chordoma. And there is loss of INI1, that is very important. And IHC-wise, all the chordomas are positive for cytokeratin, EMA, SN red protein, and brachyury is the hallmark marker, which will be positive exclusively in chordoma, which will be negative in chondrosarcoma, which is the close DD for conventional chordoma. So this is a lesion in the sacrum, and showing the cords of tumor cells with mixed, here the arrow shows the physalliferous cell, and epitheloid features are there, and myxoid matrix also we can see. So this is a case of chordoma, conventional chordoma. So morphological mimics, let us, I just want to list out all the lesions of giant cell rich lesions, ABC, osteoblastoma, GCT, chondroblastoma, osteosarcoma. In this, I will be discussing some lesions which we come across very often. So aneurysmal bone cyst, here it is an expansile lytic lesion, usually cortex is intact. So that is a clue, cortex is intact, there is no breakage in the cortex. And rim of reactive bone may be seen here and there. And grossly the cavity is separated by a septa and it may contain blood or blood clot. That is the, here there is a cavity filled with blood and there are septae. So this is an aneurysmal bone cyst and vascular space. Here the microscopy shows very peculiarly there is an absence of endothelial lining. This is a higher magnification showing lots of osteoblast giant cells and stromal thing and large areas of hemorrhage, and the vessel wall is not having endothelial lining. So molecular wise, FISH for USP6 gene rearrangement will help in these cases. So the majority of primary, so to differentiate from primary and secondary ABCs, this USP6 gene rearrangement study will be helpful. So they have typical rearrangement which are not seen in the secondary ABC or in other giant cell rich lesions. So secondary aneurysmal bone cyst may be associated with all these lesions. So the importance of knowing about this secondary aneurysmal bone cyst is, if the TrueCut biopsy contains only this area, we might call it as aneurysmal bone cyst. So in such cases, again I am insisting on seeing the X-ray. So if the X-ray is having a solid area as well as cystic area and the needle has gone into the cystic area, we would have got the secondary aneurysmal bone cyst. Adjacent areas of actual tumor is not being sampled. So we have to caution the clinician and ask for a repeat biopsy. Coming to the next entity, it is the giant cell tumor. So here the giant cell tumor is a well-defined lytic expansive lesion which is having a soap bubble appearance in epiphysis with metaphyseal extension. So grossly it is soft and dark brown, thinning of cortex, cystic areas may be seen. We can make out the difference between this and aneurysmal bone cyst. And the osteoclastic giant cells surrounded by mononuclear stromal cells, they are arranged in a spatial, that is in an orderly fashion it is arranged. And another thing is the nucleus of the osteoclast giant cell resembles the nucleus of the stromal cells. So this is the giant cell tumor, and focal mitotic activity will be seen. So by seeing the mitotic activity, we should not call it as a malignant giant cell tumor. In malignant giant cell tumor, there will be marked anaplasia and the spindle cells will be anaplastic. And here the new stain is H3.3 G34W. In chondroblastoma it is 36, here it is 34W stains. It stains only the stromal cells, not the osteoclast giant cells. Though the nucleus, they resemble each other, the nucleus of osteoclast giant cell doesn't take up the stain of H3.3 G34W. Coming to the morphological mimics, where the GCT with secondary ABC means it may be solid and cystic areas, I have already told you. So in such cases, if we do the stain H3.3 G34W, because whether to call it as GCT or ABC, we always have a dilemma. So in such cases, if we do this stain, the GCT areas will be stained by this stain, but ABC area will not take up the stain. That stromal cells in the ABC area will not take up the H3.3 stain. So we can commit as GCT with secondary ABC. In cases of solid ABC, because the solid ABC is another difficult diagnosis, because many a times we get confused with GCT as well as with the giant cell rich osteosarcoma. Here the solid areas in histology, sometimes it may have cyst, associated cyst also. Here the USP6 rearrangement by FISH will help us to diagnose the solid variant of ABC if it is a primary ABC. And giant cell rich osteosarcoma, here the marker cellular ATPA will be there and osteoid formation. I have already showed the picture of giant cell rich osteosarcoma. Here also we have to do both the stains, SAD-B2 and H3.3 G34W. So this will stain the giant cell tumor areas, and SAD-B2 will stain the neoplastic osteosarcoma cells. So this is the giant cells, these big cells, all the malignant cells will be stained by SAD-B2. So this is this I got it in the article, American Journal of Surgical Pathology. They compared the staining characteristics of H3.3 G34W in Jane cell tumor, where it is a nuclear stain, stains the stromal cells, and chondroblastoma, it is negative, as well as in aneurysmal bone cyst, as well as in the Jane cell rich osteosarcoma. So coming to the last entity, this is the brown tumor. Though it is not a tumor, it is a misnomer. But always we should think whenever a middle-aged female came with giant cell rich lesions. Excuse me. In such cases, we have to do serum markers, serum PTH, calcium, phosphorus and alkaline phosphatase. Sorry. So that will clinch the diagnosis. So this is another view of our hospital. Any doubts?
Yeah, lots of.
So now coming to the last part of our talk, this is the therapy effects on bone tumors. I have already mentioned, nowadays chemotherapy followed by limb salvage surgery is being in the practice. So different regimens of chemotherapy are given, including vincristine, ifosfamide and doxorubicin, etoposide or cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, and methotrexate in high doses are also used in some cases of osteosarcoma. Though there are different drugs are used, the chemotherapy effect most of the time it is the same on the bone. So this is a limb salvage specimen. So here we can make out the fibrosed areas and some areas of necrosis and some areas of thickening, all the things. The tumor is totally fibrosed and hyalinized. So we have to do the gridding. As I told you, here we have labeled as A, B, C, D like that. Sometimes we do it as B1, B2, B3, B4 like that also. Depends on the resident who is doing the procedure. So we have to do the gridding. We have to submit all the sections and we have to compare with the map reporting. So we have to A, B, C, D, we have to write in the format and what is the percentage of necrosis, what is the percentage of viable tumor seen, and what is the percentage of normal bone seen. So three columns we should put and we have to add everything, and percentage of necrosis, percentage of residual tumor, we have to report in the final report. Coming to the chemotherapy effects in osteosarcoma, so these are the different foci. So here we are seeing the dead bone with the necrosis and some viable cells are seen here and there. So these are the residual tumor cells, and this thing, when I saw it for the first time, I thought some fungal infection in bone, how come it is? Then I realized it, they are nothing but bone spicules. They are arranged, I mean they look like fungal filaments, and there is absolutely no tumor in this area. So this is these are the different effects in osteosarcoma. In case of Ewing sarcoma, there will be area, large areas of necrosis will be there and tiny areas. So in Ewing sarcoma, we have to be really careful because sometimes mononuclear infiltrates also resemble neoplastic cells. So in such cases, if we have doubt, we have to immediately do IHC and confirm whether they are mononuclear cells of inflammatory origin or they are neoplastic cells. There will be large areas of necrosis and these are the normal bone which are infiltrated by the tumor cells. And there is a grading by Pixie et al. So they showed the cutoffs for osteosarcoma and Ewing sarcoma response. So if it is more than 90% of tumor necrosis is there, it is appear to be good response. So according to the percentage of the tumor, they alter the chemotherapy. The intensity of the chemotherapy, they will reduce. If the resected specimen shows 90% of tumor necrosis and the patient has already received 4 cycles of chemotherapy, means next month they will reduce the intensity and make it as 50% of the drugs intensity, they will reduce to 50%. Sometimes if it is 99% of necrosis, they might stop the chemotherapy also and keep the patient under close follow-up. So it is defined by the person Pixie et al. It is from Cancer Journal. So grade 1 is less than 50%, grade 2 is 50 to 90%, grade 3 is 91 to 99% and grade 4 is 100%. 100% necrosis means it is really to commit, difficult to commit like this. 99% we can commit by seeing the sections. And treatment of GCT, here we can't call it as chemotherapy. Even for GCT also, they have started using denosumab, which has been used for the osteoporosis, routinely used for postmenopausal women for osteoporotic changes. It is the RANKL inhibitors, that is receptor activated nuclear factor, kappa inhibitor, ligand inhibitor. So this ligand helps the osteoclast processes. So this is a monoclonal antibody that reduces the tumor associated bone lysis by inhibiting the action of RANK ligand, and it arrests the osteoclastic activity and promotes the osteoblastic activity, and the inhibition of osteoblastic activity is relieved, so osteoblasts will form and new bone formation will be there, and there is a reduction in monocyte recruitment and osteoclast like germ cell formation also limited by this. So that will reduce the bone destruction. So this is the action of denosumab. So this is a section of recurrent GCT with who has been given denosumab. So after giving the denosumab, the new bone formation, the whole thing has become new bone, and bland neoplastic mutant spindle cells are seen, and depletion of osteoclasts. So we can make out there are absolutely no osteoclast giant cells. Here other fields are showing, this is a higher magnification showing the new bone formation and the fibrous tissue in between, and there are large areas of hemorrhage, and in all the fields we can see there are no osteoclast giant cells. So cystic spaces, foamy macrophages, inflammatory infiltrate, hemangiopericytoma appearance, all these things will be seen in the post-denosumab GCT cases. So to conclude, whenever we get a bone tumor, we have to see the age and sex of the patient and single or multiple and location in the skeleton, which bone is involved, and in the bone, which part of the bone is involved, and in the tumor, how is the border of the tumor, what is the type of destruction, what is the type of periosteal reaction and matrix and soft tissue mass, everything we have to see. And we should not throw the ball in others, like pathologists will tell radiologists, radiologists will clinician, like that. We all should work as a team and come to a decision. So finally, I want to list out the reporting checklist, that is radiology report is available or not. If it is available, what is the report we have to mention, and the type of resection, whether it is an amputation or limb salvage or needle biopsy we have to mention, and the specimen site, that is anatomic location and size of the lesion we have to mention, and tumor characteristics, that is tumor site, tumor size, length plus two diameters, that is all three dimension we have to mention, and distance from tumor to margins, soft tissues, if it is an amputation specimen we have to mention the soft tissue margin as well as the skin margin, because the skin will be little less compared to soft tissue, and the bony resected margin, in case any vascular vessels are seen, vascular margin also we have to take, we have to sample, as well as the bone marrow margin, and relationship to the tumor to the epiphyseal cartilage, if it is close to the joint, then joint capsule also we have to give, and synovial sampling also we should do, and cortex involvement is how we have to look into it, and soft tissue, if it is involved, we have to give the sections from the soft tissue also close to the tumor, and any skip metastasis if we are seeing in the soft tissue as well as in the bone, we have to give the sampling, and I told you, know, in the vessel also, vessel margin also we have to, and open, if the vessel is a big vessel, we have to open the vessel and give any clot or thrombus is there, means we have to sample the thrombus also, and any lymph node is there, that lymph node involvement also we have to mention in the report, and microscopic features, histological types according to the WHO classification, and status of margins we have to mention, and comparison with the pre-treatment surgical specimen is needed in case of post-chemo specimens, and percentage of necrosis with grade of chemotherapy, and results of ancillary and special studies also we have to mention. So this is the bone specimen reporting. So this is my strength. So, my pathology lab team, and thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Take a deep breath. Have a glass of water. You must be really tired.
I'm sorry, sir.
No, not at all. I am so thankful that you have come to this platform and you have delivered such a wonderful lecture. Excellent presentation. Wow. Brilliant.
Thank you, sir.
Are so many comments and questions. I mean, just have a glass of water and I'll go down first reading the comments and then the questions, right? So you can even see them on your chat box. I have copied all from the YouTube and I've pasted them here. So I'll go one by one.
Yes, sir.
So first let me just talk about the comments so that you can start presenting so that we can see you on the screen. Yeah, great. So we can see you, right? Great. So let's talk about some of the comments to start with. We have Dr. Selvam Bigai. She says, all the best, dear Susie. Then we have Dr. Meena Kumari. She says, all the best, my sister.
Thank you.
Yeah, then we have Dr. M.V. Sriram. All the best, my UG mate.
Thank you, sir.
All right, so now we'll are you ready for the questions? Can I start one by one?
Yes, sir. No problem, sir.
Yeah, so we'll go one by one. The first question which was put up was by Dr. Venkat Rao, Vishal Rao, and he said, how to assess decalcification?
How to assess the calcification?
Yeah, decalcification.
Whenever I told you, we have to use the, we have to take out day in, day out, we have to check the, take out the section and press it with the forceps and see for the texture of the tissue. If it is like a fibroid, then it is ready for this thing. If it is little softer and firmer, then it is ready for processing. If it is still feeling bony, you can just tap it. The bones sound is coming means then it is not yet calcified.
Right. Fantastic. Now there is a question, a query by Dr. Rupesh Gundawar. He wants to know which bone cutter you are using in your hospital.
A bone cutter, it is kind of, we didn't get it from a company, sir. It is custom made, sir. We got it done.
It was customized. Very nice. Right. So we have a question by Dr. Professor Pranab Kumar Bhattacharya. He says the pathological examination of malignant bone tumors takes much time for voluminous tumor. This time is needed for decalcification. Processing an accurate analysis report usually takes 15 to 50 days.
Yes.
This is his comment. I mean, this is
yes, sir. That is right.
Yeah, it does take.
So what we do as soon as we receive the amputation in the, we just keep it for 1 or 2 days. The whole amputation specimen in the formalin, sir. After that, we remove the soft tissue. I mean, all the skin, muscle, everything we remove, and actually de-skinning we will do, sir, and only the bone we will remove and leave the bone in the formalin for 2 or 3 days. Then we start cutting the bone. And the bone adherent soft tissue, we will keep it in the formalin for a while. And that also we will scrape it off before cutting the bone.
Okay.
So like that, we just make it possible to give the report within 15 days or 18 days.
All right. That's good. Another comment by Dr. Pranab Kumar Bhattacharya is, do you think that post-operative MRI is better technology to assess resection margin? And is a rapid one.
MRI is a costly procedure, sir.
Yeah, true. It is a costly procedure.
Yeah.
On the research lab, it is fine. But on a diagnostic setup, it will be very difficult.
And another thing, for bone lesions, I think CT is better than MRI, sir.
Alright. Yeah. Okay, that's true. Yeah. Dr. Minesh Gandhi from Rajkot, he's a very well-known pathologist there. He says, does post-treatment of bone tumor affect histology, especially the retained IHC markers like BCOR?
Yes, sir. Because, I mean, if it is post-treatment, usually without knowing BCOR mutation, they won't give the chemotherapy, sir. If it is treated as the Ewing sarcoma, then there may be some defect in the FISH test, sir.
Yeah, that is what he's trying to ask, whether after post-treatment, you know, BCOR IHC would be there or not, whether the IHC would be retained or not?
Yes, sir. So all the IHCs after decalcification itself, it is very difficult to get the IHC, especially after post-chemo and all that. We are taking a chance. We can't be 100% sure.
Yeah, we are not sure, right. Dr. Amutaravi says, all the best, Sushila.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Minesh Gandhi has another question. How to differentiate osteoblastoma from osteoblastoma like osteosarcoma?
We have to look for mitosis and anaplasia. And SADB2 comes positive in osteosarcoma. It doesn't come osteoblastoma that much well. And again, we have to see the radiology. And osteosarcoma will have all the features.
Right, right. There is another question by Dr. Minesh Gandhi. He says, chondroid tumor arising from the head and neck looks like a chondroma, but size is 1.5 centimeter. Should we always label it as atypical chondroid tumor or grade 1 chondrosarcoma?
To label it as, it is in axial skeleton, it is not in appendicular skeleton. So it should be called as chondrosarcoma according to the book. But since the size of the lesion is 1.5 centimeter, we should look into the radiology and see what is the margin, what is the margin of the lesion and all that. And since it is neck, and chondrosarcoma doesn't have any chemotherapy or radiotherapy. So we have to sample the region and compare with the radiology and wait. And what is the age of the patient also we have to see.
Yeah, right. Clinical and radiological correlation would be very essential. Right?
Essential, yes, sir.
Absolutely right. Dr. Afroz Shireen, she says, she wants to know how will we differentiate between giant cell tumor of the bone and the giant cell tumor of tendon sheath?
Yes, sir. Giant cell tumor of bone will be H3.3 positive, and tendon sheath will not be there. And the involvement also. Before the marker, we should see the clinical picture as well as which part of the bone is involved. Tendon sheath means it involves the soft tissue. There will be absolutely no bone in that. So we can call it as giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. Nowadays, it is being called as solid ABC also in some places.
Right. Correct. Dr. Minesh Gandhi wants to know how to differentiate chondromyxoid fibroma from chondrosarcoma in small bones of feet.
Chondrosarcoma will have only chondroid elements. There will be no fibromatous elements will be there in chondrosarcoma, especially small bones of feet. And CMF involves the young adult, young children and teenagers. But chondrosarcoma occurs in old age.
Right, absolutely right. And regarding denosumab, you have already spoken, so we will not talk about that. Then we have Dr. Amatulu Mungesh. He says, awesome class, ma'am. Dr. Subbalakshmi says, great lecture. Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Venkat Rao says, thank you, ma'am, for such a wonderful lecture. Dr. Pranab has another question. Do you think that therapy blocking proliferation of stromal cells, such as drug inhibiting cell cycle progression or telomerase activity, could be effective?
Sorry, sir, it is out of our subject.
Absolutely true. Absolutely true. I think we should call in somebody from
oncology.
Yeah, oncomedicines to handle that. Dr. Mahalakshmi Shankar says, wonderful and detailed presentation by Dr. Sushila. You rocked. Dr. Daphne Infancia says, madam, your comments on the role of frozen section in bone tumors.
Actually, frozen section we can't do in bone tumors for diagnosis, but for demonstrating the bone resected margins, especially soft tissue margins and bone marrow, we routinely get marrow scoopings at the time of limb salvage surgery. The surgeon has to decide till what length, because he doesn't want to sacrifice more normal normal bone. So what he does, whenever he reams the bone, he takes scoops out the bone marrow and sends it for a frozen section, which we can do until the bone marrow is not involved and it is free. Then he gives the soft tissue also. If we tell the soft tissue is also free, so he considers the resectant margin is optimal and he stops cutting there only. He will not take more normal bone.
Right. Definition of the resection margin is very essential in frozen section.
Yes. True.
There's a comment by Dr. Mahalakshmi Shankar. Very proud to hear such kind words about my big sister from Dr. Nadeem. My God, thank you. Dr. Meena Kumar, very well done, Dr. Sushila. Very detailed and very clearly presented. You prove that you are very thorough of the subject. Very impressed. Very well done. I agree with every word of Dr. Meena Kumar.
Thank you,
Dr.
sir.
Dr. Harveen Gulati, great lecture, ma'am. Thank you. Dr. Selvam Bigyai says, well done, Dr. Sushila. Nice presentation. Wonderful, ma'am. I think you have done a wonderful job. I wish I could give you a standing ovation. Excellently done. So nice.
Thanks, sir.
So many comments, so many questions, very nicely handled. So great. We will surely like to have you. We are having you again with the case presentation next week.
Yes,
right.
Sir.
So we'll all look forward to that. Thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you everybody for joining in. Okay, we close the session here. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye. Good night.
Thanks a lot, sir. Good night, sir.
Thank you.
Thank
bye-bye.
You
good night. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Hello. 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 No, it's a problem.